Hello, everyone, and welcome back to Bitwig Studio and Music Production. This is lesson 5.64, and in this lesson, I wanted to do one final detour before we really jump into the FM4 full throttle, and that's just a quick kind of look at the evolution of FM synthesis to see where it started and to now see where it's gone. And in a lot of ways, you're going to notice that those fundamental principles of FM synthesis are nowhere to be found, yet people still will say, oh, okay, well, that's utilizing FM in some kind of way. And I want you to see through that how in some cases, just because somebody might be using an FM synthesizer, a modern one, doesn't mean that they're actually doing any kind of FM at all. All right, so let's just go ahead and jump in. If you'll remember from what John Chowning said, he first discovered this concept of FM in the 1960s, and he was a composer, and he was specifically using it to make brass sounds and these other sort of real-life acoustic sounds that you could never get with subtractive synthesizers. Also, remember that at his time, we didn't have multi-sampled instruments. We didn't have samplers. He wasn't able to load up a version of Kontakt and have a perfect piano for him right at that time. We have to think that electronic composers were trying to use the technology they had access to and push it in as many ways as they possibly could. In a lot of ways, we still do that today, just the framework for it is a little bit different. And I'm sure I'll talk about that more as this course progresses. If you have more questions on that, feel free to let me know and I could really explain that. But we can take a look at this Mini-Moog Voyager, and we'll notice that the original Mini Moog was out in the 70s, and it also had the ability for FM, not as easy and well-defined as this is, but you can see that on this particular analog synth that came out in 1970 originally, there was an option for FM. You could use oscillator 3 to evoke frequency modulation on oscillator number 1. Okay, so this is more of like a simple kind of FM, in that we only have one sort of relationship here. We can only do it in this one way. With the FM4, we obviously have four different oscillators and or operators that can be used to frequency modulate any other. But even early on, frequency modulation was something being built into analog subtractive synths. If we look at the Virus B, now this is, of course, a virtual analog emulation. We also have an FM amount right here that we can turn up or down. Simple FM synthesis, but it's been around and it's in so many synthesizers today, you just may not even realize it. But getting to where FM kind of turned away from being more of an analog technology occurred in the 1980s, late 70s, early 80s, when the Yamaha DX-7 was introduced. So this uses digital technology, so it has computer chips and everything running inside it, much like the Virus B has, and so it's not really hardwired the way something like a Mini Moog is, which made this thing very, very cheap, and you can actually still pick these up for like under $300 if you want. Now, programming these is an absolute nightmare, but this was the first kind of commercial usage of what John Chowning had first talked about and discovered in the late 60s, in that this used six different operators, and we can count them here if you look at these algorithms, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, to make the sounds. And this was really used to make a lot of acoustic sounding instruments, and its first real primary function was to replace the role of the studio musician. A composer or producer could have access to one of these DX7s, they could load up whatever preset they wanted, and then with that preset, they'd be able to kind of emulate a horn section or strings or especially percussion and lay it down, multi-track it that way. And then when the actual instrumentalists had to come in, they wouldn't have to pay them for studio sessions. They just have to use them on the actual recording. But eventually, people actually started to use this in their own music. And the DX7 is so famously heard on almost every track in the 80s, both popular music and experimental music. Most people were just sticking to the presets like Sting and Madonna and Paula Abdul, but others were actually trying to get in here and program it. Truth be told, you may not want to buy one of these, even though they're cheap, because you can really get the exact same sounds inside of something like FM8, and programming FM8 is not as much a headache as this. There were probably maybe a handful of people who really knew how to program this guy. Everybody else just kind of stuck to the presets. So where FM, I think, really was able to have a resurgence after people got really tired of that sound from the 80s, those same string sounds and bass sounds, we have things like this popping up, plug-in emulations of classic FM synthesizers, or really FM synthesizers going in new directions. In the case of the DX-7, this only used sine waves, okay? So each of those operators was only capable of a sine wave at its start, and you had to evoke different types and forms of modulation if you wanted to have any other new and interesting timbres come out of it. Something like the operator gives you access to a whole number of different wave shapes, and you can set whatever wave shape you want in these various four operators that you have access to, A, B, C, D. And down here, we see the algorithm control, okay? And so this is saying that, This is saying that operators A, B, and C can all be modulated by operator D. All right, if you're confused about that, don't worry. FL Studio, they have an FM synthesizer as well called Citrus. This one has a filter. We also noticed that the Ableton Live has a filter. The classic DX7 never had that. So you didn't have the luxury of, okay, I can just make something really complicated and filter out later. No, you had to come up with something pretty good at the time, or you were never going to be able to bring the sound back. And I think that's why FM synthesis always kind of gets a bad rap, even today. People don't realize that if you stick to ratios and the like, you can get some pretty good sounds, but it is very hard. It's very nuanced. Something like the operator or Citrus gives you a little bit more flexibility in that you have a filter and an additional LFO, et cetera, et cetera. And in Bitwig, we also could add filters and things in the FX, but by default of kind of all FM synthesizer plugins that are available to you, this is one of the more accurate ones out there because we don't have any filter, right? We just have our modulation matrix here and we have our different coarse tunings and fine tunings and things that we can set. And then we have our different envelope generators, which we could map if we wanted to number two, map to number two, we could three to number three, four to number four. And we'll be looking at all of that in much greater detail. I just thought I'd show this to you guys now. And also, I've provided for you guys a playlist of kind of the evolution of FM. And so I started with a few works by John Chowning, and these are really good, and he's a great composer in his own right. He doesn't really get any respect or acknowledgement as a composer, except in very kind of elitist electronic music circles. But even for those of you who are interested in making trap or hip hop, I really want you to open up your ears and open up your minds to different types of music and realize that when he was making these things, nobody had ever tried to use FM before. This stuff takes a really long time. These are three pretty famous compositions of his. And then I also have a couple of tracks that I really like that use the DX7. Paula Abdul's Straight Up, that's probably one of my favorite tracks of all time. Don't judge me. Madonna's Live to Tell, listen to the bass line in there. If you're listening to Paula Abdul, listen to the horns. Listen to everything. You can really hear that a lot of it has a sound of like a synthesizer, but not really like an analog synthesizer, something different. And that was the DX7. Enya also used the DX7. And then last but not least, we have our buddy Skrillex here. I have to be honest, like today was only the second time I'd ever been able to listen to this track in its entirety, but it goes to show how far FM has gone and how someone like Skrillex has taken the concept of the DX7 of just these simple sine waves trying to make acoustic sounds and really flipped it on its head. So in a lot of ways, Skrillex is similar to Chowning because he's taking a technology and completely trying to push it as far as possible. And that's how evolution in music occurs. A new technology comes out. It has a very specific purpose, right? Think about the 808, 909, 707 drum machines, what those were originally designed for and what they ended up being used for. And then think about something like FM synthesis and the DX7 starting as just kind of the basics for these pop musicians like Paula and Madonna. Starting in experimental circles, moving into pop realms, and really if you listen to anything from the 80s, you can kind of guarantee a DX7 is in there somewhere, up to our boy Skrillex here. And I wanted to talk a little bit about Skrillex and his usage of the FM8, because this is where things get a little bit convoluted and a little bit more confusing. Now, I honestly don't know Skrillex. I don't know him personally. I'm sure he's a really nice guy, But he says that he uses the FM8 for a number of his bass sounds, for his really dirty, grimy bass sounds. And it's probably true, but FM8 is not really just a frequency modulation-based synthesizer. And that's what I'm going to show you. I'm not going to even show you the frequency modulation components of this synth, because I don't really think it's worth going into, but I want you to see how evolution and technology has changed so much. And if we take a look at this here, all right, what I'm going to do is start at this point. We can see that we have all these different waveforms. So that right there is a little bit different from what you would expect with an FM synthesizer. So I could just load in a bunch of sawtooth waves, and maybe we'll try some of these other ones here. We have Formants and TXs. Let's try that guy. Let's try this one. I don't really know what these sound like, to be honest. And we'll add in another sawtooth. And so typically for FM to work, we have to go into additional oscillators here. So one oscillator would have the output, and then we'd use these different oscillators or operators to modulate. I'm not going to do that. I'm actually going to work this like a subtractive synthesizer. And with the FM8, we also have a built-in saturator device. Interesting. And we have a filter. Okay, so everything we've just talked about FM has kind of been flipped on its head. And that's totally fine. There's nothing wrong with that. But I just want you guys realizing that something like FM8, don't get so intimidated when people say that they're using this for FM synthesis, because the FM synthesis parts are pretty easy. It's all the bells and whistles that are going to really confuse you and bother you with something like this. But I can run these guys into, for example, let's run into the saturator first. Turn the saturator on, run the saturator at the output. So now I should hear something if I turn this on. All right, perfect. And I can open these other guys up, and I'm just running these into the saturator as if this was a subtractive synth. I'm not doing any frequency modulation. Let's run that one in. Let's go look at B. Let's change this ratio so we're an octave up. Add little bits of detuning in here. Perfect. I can go into C. Let's add some of this guy in here too. All right, perfect. Let me just go into X and turn this down a little bit. Let's add in all of these guys. Why not? Just for fun. Let's go crazy with it. Let's go down an octave. Let's take this one in D and let's put it at 0.5. So again, just an octave relationship. Cool. Let's run this one in. Then we have F. Okay, this is back to a saw. I'll put this one at 0.5 too. Why not? Maybe I'll actually use this one as a sine so I can get a little bit of sub going on. And I'm just going to turn up my headphones. All right, so that's pretty dirty sounding right there. We haven't even used any FM on this. And oh, look at this. We also have an effects section. What could I throw in here? I can throw in an overdrive. Oh, I also have a tube amp. I can add more distortion. Great. Do I want maybe a cabinet? now we're talking. But you know what? It's getting a little bit too crazy for me in the top end there. Maybe I can go back into my operator section here and run this into a filter. So now I've run this into a filter. I've really cut this off pretty extreme. So I'm only showing you this because I want you to realize that FM synthesis comes in many shapes and sizes. And what I've done here is not FM synthesis. I have used an FM synthesizer, but I've used it as a subtractive synthesizer. I've jumped into the effects. I've messed around there. I could really push this in a number of different directions if I wanted. Like I could add multiple voices and things. I could add more of a digital quality to it, or more of an analog. I just want to show this to you because I know a lot of people talk about synthesizers like FM8 or like Massive, and they can seem very intimidating when you get started. But if you understand just a little bit on how the navigation and thing works in here, this would all make a lot of sense to you. It may not make sense to you at this point, but that's okay because we're going to be looking at an FM synthesizer like an FM synthesizer. For now, it's as if we've just run all of these guys in parallel and we haven't really even used frequency modulation. If I wanted, I could evoke some frequency modulation in this. At this point, it's almost like too late. But anyway, I just want you guys to hear, you know, here are some actual classic FM sounds. These are like modeled after DX-7 presets. Classic. A real classic bass sound. And if we look at this in the expert tab here, there are no effects going on. All we have is just really basic FM occurring, and we get this really classic Madonna-esque bass sound. And it could be a guitar, I guess. If we go up an octave, we have something like this. And then it gets really crazy here with something that is using a number of different waveforms. We have this running into the saturator, running into the filter. I didn't even talk about the saturator. All sorts of effects, lots of morphing controls going on here. So again, this is where it really does become like the best of both worlds. We are using some FM synthesis here, but we're also going very far away from its traditional usage. I know I've kind of rambled and blabbered on in this video, but the point is very simple. It's that FM synthesis is very easy. It's very approachable. But in today's modern society and how things have evolved so quickly, a new producer or new creator coming in is going to see an instrument like that and want to slam their head against a wall because there's just so many choices and so many options. When we start to explore the FM4, I hope you'll realize that this is a really great organic example of a classic FM synthesizer. And if we want all the bells and whistles, we can just add them in like so. So thank you so much for watching, and you'll hear from me again in the next lesson. Take care.